Here are some HackHeld designs that didn't make it, including some small ones and some very big ones. Let's start with the small one. This is still based on the ESP8266, as you can see when I turn it around. This is one of the D1 mini boards, but the Pro variant. So you have an external antenna connector. The reason why I use this is because it's flat. It doesn't have any components on the other side. So I was able to solder it directly on the PCB. It still uses micro USB, unfortunately. But as you can see, it runs the ESP8266, the offer firmware. And yeah, it's just like the big HackHeld and the classic D-offer firmware. But yeah, this one didn't make it. I don't really see a reason for this board. It is small, but this isn't easily soldered. If I include header pins, then it gets relatively thick and loses the whole point of it being small. And there's also no place for a battery. Combine that with the fact that soldering these buttons isn't really easy, and that the original HackHeld is supposed to be a fun and easy DIY project, it doesn't really make sense. Another one of the old designs that didn't make it is this HackHeld Altair. Altair is one of three stars. The other two are Vega. This is the original HackHeld Vega design. And Deneb, which is what I called this small one here. The idea was that instead of a D1 Mini, I use one of those Adafruit feather boards. And this is quite cool because the feather boards also have LiPo battery support and a charger and everything you need built in. And you can also connect an on and off switch. So a lot of things going for it, but I didn't like that it made the whole PCB so wide, even wider than the original Vega. And yeah, with the current one, it's much smaller. Here's a comparison. Yeah, I didn't really like the form factor. The other problem with it is that these feather boards are rather expensive. And that just doesn't make sense for a project that is supposed to be cheap. And using those development boards, well, it would have made it so much more expensive. I gave up on it. Okay, moving on. We have two prototypes here. What I tried here is to make the case and everything as thin as possible. So you can see here that I also soldered on the development board directly to the PCB. No pin header in between. Not really ideal. Not always that easy to solder, but I wanted to see how thin can I get this device. And yeah, this is pretty thin. I also soldered on one of those ESP32S2 chips. But yeah, no firmware running on these. I instead decided that if I make a D-offer that runs on the ESP32, that I also upgrade the screen and kind of rethink the whole UI. Which brings us to the prototypes that use an LCD screen. Here we have a really small one. As you can see, it is inspired by this design. This is the old one that uses the 8266 with the OLED screen. But this one is using a ESP32. This is the M5 stamp module. It runs a simple example sketch to test if the buttons are working. This is actually a design that might still come in handy with the new firmware I'm working on, because that could also run on this tiny screen with some changes in the UI, of course. But otherwise, it should be doable. The deal breaker for me with this design was again the development board. It wasn't cheap and easily accessible enough for my taste. But I wanted to try it out and it works. Moving on to the bigger designs. Here is one that is not using a development board. Instead, I designed a PCB myself with an ESP32 directly on board, as well as a SD card slot, LiPo battery, on and off switch, and USB port. But I wanted to show you these PCBs to tell you about our sponsor, JLCPCB, who manufactured all of these. All of the different PCBs I've shown you, including those small ones, were made by JLCPCB. They are quite fast and affordable, and ordering your design is quite easy. You just upload your Gerber files, you get a preview, you can select some of the options, and then that's it. You check out, you pay. And if you have a simple design, then often they are manufactured within 24 hours. I also sometimes use their assembly service, for example, for a design like this, I cannot hand solder. JLC does that for me. Their assembly service is also quite fast and affordable and makes my life so much easier. Check out the link in the video description. Thanks, JLC, for sponsoring. And now let's continue looking at board designs. This is the front side. And you can see I added some bigger buttons and also a bunch of LEDs here and a bigger screen. This is still an OLED screen. In this case, it's one with yellow LEDs instead of the white or blue ones you typically see. It looks quite cool and I like the big pixels. I think I could happily live with a low resolution monochrome screen for my UI, but the space between the pixels are pretty big and it makes looking at the screen for a while kind of exhausting. The firmware I have here is also just to test if everything is working, and it does. Yeah. So then I took the same PCB and soldered on a LCD screen. And here we have basically the same example sketch with this list menu that you can go through. And yeah, I think the screen looks a lot better. Obviously, it has a higher resolution. This is one of the IPS panel versions of these LCD screens you can find. It looks much better than the OLED. I wanted to make a HackHeld Pro. So this is the Pro to Type 1. Obviously, it didn't came to that, at least not yet. Let's continue looking at board designs, including this big boy. As you can see, it also uses one of those feather development boards. Here it's an ESP32 variant. I think I designed this because I wanted to find out what it feels and looks like to have a design with the biggest LCD screen I could find that still easily works with microcontrollers like this. Of course, there are bigger screens. There are always bigger screens. But this is the largest one of these standard Arduino LCDs you can find on places like AliExpress. And yeah, this is what it looks like. Actually, every time I look at it, it's funny. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I just wanted to try it out. It is a cool design. I really like the grid I did here. However, this is probably not the best idea. So yeah, those were all the old designs I made, but didn't really continue working on them. But before I end this video, I want to show you this. A HackHeld 32 design, like the one I showed you in my last video, but with an ESP32C5 development board. The board is larger than the HackHeld PCB itself, but this is not final. This is just to see if it works. And guess what? It does. So this is running the exact same firmware I have shown you in my last two videos. It is the Offer32 firmware that I'm currently working on. It can scan and find 5 GHz networks. It can also deauthenticate 5 GHz networks. We are almost there. As I'm recording this video, the ESP32C5 chip itself, or module in this case, are in mass production but are not available for purchase yet. So all I have right now is this, which works fine for testing the new firmware. And in my next video, I will finally be able to talk more about this. The HackHeld 32 design that I'm currently working with, that I quite like, that has an external antenna, as well as the full color LCD screen, SD cards, expansion, pin headers, buttons, LED, everything you have seen in this small little design. It has almost the same footprint as the current HackHeld Vega you can buy in my store. It's just a tiny bit bigger, but that's pretty much it. And then I will also be able to go over the firmware with the new features I have been working on. As of the time of recording this, I am not yet selling the HackHeld 32, but I will be. I'm planning on releasing this design as well as the DIY design. And then hopefully in the near future, the C5 version as well. Until then, thank you for watching and subscribe and all that stuff. And if you find any of this interesting, check out my website and my online store. Thanks for watching. Bye bye.